pleasure to be here. Thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity to present today's work on social protection, which I was conducting collaboratively with my colleague Rachel Slater at ODI. So as Marcus was saying, we're going to start with a brief overview of the context that Marcus already introduced in terms of the current drought, particularly in Eastern Africa and Southern Africa. Then what is social protection, a general overview of what kind of progress we're talking about, what are the main objectives, and how is this linked to resilience? And then I will present some of the findings from the research we're doing that was looking specifically at what the contribution of existing social protection programs are on building resilience. And then conclude with three reflections at the end, which will hopefully then feed into a discussion at the end with the panel. So as Marcus was saying, we're currently facing again a drought, a heavy drought in Eastern Africa, and it is a combination of consecutive droughts for the last 2 years. ECHO estimates that in Ethiopia, Kenya, and Somalia alone, 10.7 million people are in need of food assistance. And we're again asking ourselves in this situation, how can we actually develop and deliver humanitarian assistance on time to the people who need it? But even beyond that, how can we actually avoid that we get into these situations where we actually have to get emergency support again? How can we aim to build resilience so that people manage to avoid these type of disasters? And one of the policy responses that is being mentioned more frequently as one response to disasters and climate risk is social protection. So what is social protection? It is a range of different types of programs that aim to reduce vulnerability to risks. And these can be all sorts of different risks, economic risks or risks related to a stage in your life, like being a child, being pregnant, being old age. And it does so by providing cash or in-kind support, so for example, food assistance, to allow people to meet their most basic needs when they face those risks. And social protection programs take a range of different forms and functions. And what I mean by form is the way to deliver the assistance. So the most common one people know are cash transfers, so basically delivering cash to people. We also have public works programs, which are basically cash for work. So people get cash in exchange for labor, which is usually to build community assets. And in exchange for that, they get short-term employment. Again, with the idea to help them smooth consumption, to bridge the food gap. So those are the forms of delivery. But then we have the function. And these can be very different despite having similar types of delivery mechanisms. So if you look at cash transfers, we can have conditional cash transfers, which have the objective of breaking the intergenerational transmission of poverty by giving people cash, but also expecting them to send their kids to school, to send them to health clinics. We can have cash transfers that aim to provide protection in old age. So people get cash simply because they have passed a certain age, and it's aimed to help them reduce the vulnerability in old age. And we also have cash transfers for safety nets that specifically aim to address food security. And that is where we're increasingly seeing also a focus of policymakers and academics to see how cash transfers and how social protection programs generally can reduce vulnerability to climate-related risks. So we have seen a range of reports looking at adaptive social protection, looking at shock-responsive social protection. And together with my colleague at ODI, we were kind of interested in looking at, okay, so we have all these theories around how social protection is considered to contribute to reducing vulnerability to climate change and building resilience, but what is it actually doing? So we wanted to look at resilience. And resilience is a big concept. There are lots of different definitions across different disciplines. There isn't necessarily clarity on what exactly resilience means and how it looks like. So we used a framework that looks at resilience capacities. It's called the 3A framework, because we look at absorptive, anticipatory, and adaptive capacity. I'm going to explain what we mean by that. So absorptive capacity basically means the capacity of people or systems to absorb a shock while it happens. So it is right after the shock occurs. So for example, if there's a hurricane and it destroys my house, I have some savings, so it means I can rebuild my house, so the shock didn't really have that detrimental impact on me. Anticipatory capacity means my capacity to anticipate in advance, to be better prepared for the eventuality of a shock. So for example, disaster management plans, or putting in place early warning systems, so that actually once the disaster happened, you can just reduce your vulnerability to it. And then there's adaptive capacity that looks much more at the longer term adaptation that needs to take place to accommodate climate risk and to avoid that they affect you. So for example, if you're a farmer, you could shift the type of crops from like climate sensitive crops to drought resistant crops. Or you could diversify your livelihood so you're not so dependent on climate sensitive livelihoods. So looking at these three capacities, we wanted to see how is social protection right now, the programs that we have, how are they contributing to building those capacities? And when we look at absorptive capacity, social protection's contribution is the strongest. And it is quite straightforward because, as I said before, its main role is to protect people from risks. So by providing regular income transfers, social protection allows people to absorb shocks. And for example, the productive safety net program in Ethiopia was specifically put in place to support food insecure households during times of drought and following a drought when there is a food gap. And the PSNP has been fairly successful in smoothing consumption, also preventing the distressed sale of assets that households engage with when they don't have anything else to fall back onto, which can then have long-lasting consequences on the vulnerability. But you might say, well, this isn't entirely surprising because the program is there to respond to drought. But we also have other programs that are not at all aiming to respond to drought-induced food security, like, for example, an old age pension, which delivers, in Uganda, a regular monthly cash transfer to older people. And when we look at what people actually do with that, it's very similar to what they do with the cash from a safety net program that was designed specifically for drought. They use it to buy food, they use it to protect their assets. In the case of an emergency, they rely on that to be able to meet their basic needs. When we look at anticipatory capacity, the social protection can contribute at two different levels. So if we look at the individual level, people save. That's all they can do. They say, well, in case of a shock, I'm saving. And when there's a shock, I'm going to use my savings. So I can invest that in assets, I can invest it in livestock. Particularly pastoralist communities invested also in their social networks. They actually share the cash because when times are hard, that's what's going to help them out, having access to those networks. But we also see that social protection can build anticipatory capacity at the institutional level. So by putting in place systems that allow the program to scale up in the case of an emergency. So for example, you have a safety net program that delivers regular cash transfers to chronically food insecure people. But you have mechanisms in place that allow it to then scale up support in the case of an emergency. So reach additional numbers of people. The Hunger Safety Net Program in Kenya is one prime example for that. And it manages to do that because it has from the start put in place an action plan, from targeting to having funding in place, to knowing how to deliver it, to knowing what the trigger is to release those funds. This is all set in place before the disaster happens and allows to facilitate response much faster than traditional humanitarian assistance. But when we look at adaptive capacity, the contribution of social protection isn't quite as clear. And there's a lot of rhetoric around it, how it can potentially contribute to adaptive capacity. For example, by building assets like conservation or conserving the environment, by building infrastructure. There are lots of ideas of how assets built through public works programs, for example, can build adaptive capacity, but the evidence isn't quite there. And what is clear is that the cash transfer that helps people absorb shocks is too little to really make any meaningful investment so that people can adapt in the long term. So what is needed are complementary programs. And in Ethiopia, for example, the Productive Safety Net Program has envisioned to allow people who receive cash transfers to have access to complementary programs, which can then increase also the productivity. So these are just generally like the contributions that social protection can make to building these capacities. And we basically looked at it from the existing evidence that there was, and we also conducted research in Kenya and in Uganda to talk to people about how they use the cash and how this helps them cope better with climate risks. And three things came out that for us were kind of like important. First of all, so what does this mean about social protection's main contribution to resilience? And I apologize for the amount of text on this slide, but there is, you can also look it up in the paper, but basically what we try to do is like, okay, we've got like all this mixed picture of different ways social protection is contributing to resilience capacities. The most evident contribution, as I said before, is in the middle column, which is the household and individual level. So at the household and individual level, social protection helps people to absorb shocks. It also helps them to save, so they're better prepared in the case of a shock. But then there are also other outcomes that are not the primary role of social protection, but could have potentially good outcomes on resilience. So on the left, we have the environmental outcomes, which, as I mentioned before, are expected to mainly come from building assets. So for example, increasing the environment's absorptive capacity through public works by doing soil and water conservation activities, or increasing the anticipatory capacity by putting in place infrastructure that reduces the risk of disasters, or by promoting adaptation through conservation farming. These are all activities that are add-ons to the primary role of social protection to provide protection for in the case of a shock. And on the right, we have the institutional and the outcomes at the institutional systems level. And these mainly come from putting in place systems. Like, they are specific to social protection program when that those are the systems for delivering a social protection program, but they're not necessarily linked to the primary function of social protection. So the first one says, for the absorptive capacity at the institutional level, putting in place effective delivery mechanisms that can deliver assistance even during times of crisis. So having in place robust delivery mechanisms that can still do their job when things are a bit harder. And the next one is anticipatory capacity at the institutional level, which is putting in place delivery mechanisms, contingency plans to deliver emergency assistance through social protection. Like, this again is a way to just deliver assistance faster. And then at the bottom of the institutional level, we have providing linkages between social protection and other livelihood programs, which is basically where you have to have the social protection plus something else that has to be provided, ideally by programs outside of social protection in the wider system of programs that will then help to bring about adaptation. So yes, we have absorptive capacity at the individual level, but something to note is that people are able to absorb shocks because they are part of the social protection program. If the social protection program goes, in most of the cases, they won't have the absorptive capacity anymore. The other thing to note is that anticipatory capacity at the institutional level allows to deliver humanitarian assistance faster. Like, the HS&P can deliver additional support within days. The PSNP managed to do it within 6 weeks instead of 13 months, what was the usual amount of time for food aid to reach people. But this is still humanitarian assistance. This is humanitarian assistance delivered through a social protection program. It's not social protection in itself. It's still one of support to help people in a particular time. And the other thing to note is just the big question marks we have around adaptive capacity. And this is something which is important, because if in social protection we want to reduce vulnerability of people, it has to be not only vulnerability today, but also future vulnerability. And social protection isn't particularly good at bringing in climate risks into their concept of vulnerability, and also thinking about the longer term impacts of climate risks on people's livelihoods. So this is something that we have to discuss, as well as how can we actually build effective linkages to other types of programs. The other point, the other reflection, is isomorphic mimicry, which I don't know if anyone remembers this from biology. No? Sorry for those who don't like snakes, but I thought this was the best way of showing what it is. So basically, isomorphic mimicry can be found with animals and humans, which basically means that, for example, this snake, the top right one, is very poisonous. The one in the middle is not so poisonous, but it decided to look like a poisonous snake, hoping that if an enemy sees it, it will think that it's the poisonous one and it will be successful. Basically, isomorphic mimicry means copying the look of something without having the capacity to deliver effectively on this. And on the other hand, we have like a little gray snake, which is Papuan Taipan, which Wikipedia told me is a very poisonous snake. But it doesn't look particularly poisonous, but it still manages to deliver on the threat. It is highly poisonous action situation. So what does this have to do with social protection? With this whole hype around the need to build resilience, we see a lot of programs that look the same. On paper, they are pretty similar. In terms of resilience building programs, we usually have one that has a public works component that through the public works aims through conservation work, builds adaptive capacity. It also has a cash or food transfer involved. Ideally, it has a shock responsive element, so it's able to deliver additional support. But when we look at what actually they can deliver in practice, there are not that many that can do, that can perform as they say. And we also have programs that look very differently in terms of their objectives, but actually achieve to do the same thing. So we mentioned, I mentioned earlier the old age pension in Uganda, which actually has nothing to do with resilience, and no one even thinks that it could be associated with resilience. But it is a vital support for people living in rural areas which have to deal with drought. So what we learned from this is that what you do is really more important for resilience than what you make it look like. Delivery is critical, and good quality delivery is critical for resilience. The other thing is that we need to have coherence between the objective of a program and the different delivery mechanisms to actually achieve the objectives. Which leads to the next point around realistic expectations. Expectations of social protection programs are very high, and they don't always match capacity to deliver, as I mentioned previously. But the need to build resilience actually requires programs to add on all sorts of interventions into one program. But this is not necessarily easy to do within a short amount of time. So I mentioned the Ethiopia Productive Safety Net program, which is an incredibly large program. It reaches around 8 million people, I think, and it has been in place for around 12 years. It took a long time for the program to actually deliver its most basic function of being a good safety net program that delivers support to the right people at the right time. And now it is slowly adding on other things to it that will allow it to kind of build linkages, to have a risk financing mechanism in place. Similarly with the hunger safety net program in Kenya, this program has also been in place for 10 years. So we have to be realistic of what we can achieve in a certain amount of time. And rather than one program trying to do everything, seeing where does a particular type of program fit in. So just to conclude, social protection's key contribution to resilience is to reduce the negative impact of shocks, and this has to be strengthened. There are a lot of additional things that can be done that are good, like shock responsiveness, like delivering humanitarian assistance through social protection programs. But the core function is to provide this bare minimum that allows people to survive in situations of chronic food insecurity as well as in seasonal food insecurity. Social protection can be a vehicle for effective humanitarian assistance in certain contexts where the systems are in place. But a focus on shock response should not bring us back to short-term assistance. And I'm just saying this because if you look at, again, Kenya and Ethiopia, the safety net programs came in as a response to interrupt the year-on-year humanitarian assistance that was delivered because of situations of drought. This was considered inefficient, costly, and it didn't reach people on time. So we put then in place permanent safety nets people can fall back onto. If we now start focusing again on how to make those permanent safety nets shock responsive, this is okay as long as we don't go backwards and thinking again about humanitarian assistance in a better and faster way, but still as kind of a one-off support. And building resilience is complex, and it cannot be achieved by one program alone. And we need to understand the comparative advantage of different sectors in a wider resilience building agenda. So social protection itself shouldn't really build resilience by itself, because I personally think this is impossible. But it could be done within a wider context. And as long as the programs do what they're doing well and are linked up with others, which is easier said than done, But then that is how potentially we could reach resilience to drought. Thank you very much.
You have been working for many years on the Productive Safety Net program in Ethiopia, which has been set up explicitly, among other goals, as an instrument against hunger in Ethiopia. Can you tell us a little bit about the program in more details and its short and long-term effects? I mean, you have studied this carefully. And how successful the program has been in improving food security and drought resilience in Ethiopia. In the end, I think what is interesting for us, can this program serve as an example for other countries as well?
The PSMP is a program designed to do two things, to protect households from falling into chronic poverty, and by doing so, to prevent asset depletion as a result of shocks. But the PSMP is a uniquely positioned program in Ethiopia. So what we know is what is written in literature here and there, but the history of the program goes back to the strategy design of policy in Ethiopia, particularly the food security strategy that was designed in 1996, which had three important pillars. One of them was the social protection element. The others included production in the high potential areas and linking this low potential and high potential through access to food and income generating activities. So the PSMP has a long history, it's been in the process, and it's part and parcel of the overall policy making in Ethiopia. It's not just started in 2005, it started, actually, the thinking started in 1996, but was triggered by the emergency in 2002 and 2003. So the PSMP has some unique features in it. One of them is actually also mentioned by Martina, which is the P in the PSMP. The PSMP is a productive safety net program. The P in the first P in the PSMP is productive. So the idea being, households that are labor within the household are expected to do something and get something in return. So they work. So there's this public work program attached to this, which is as a condition to the transfers made. So it's not just cash transfer, but also work. This work is very important because it contributes to the resilience element also mentioned earlier, discussed earlier. This is working on community assets, building schools, roads, environmental rehabilitation, building health posts, and so on. These are important components that we should not forget in the social protection program in Ethiopia. There is the direct support element. The direct support component is particularly focusing on households that do not have able-bodied person in the household that cannot support themselves, but are supported directly through cash transfers or food transfers. So it's not conditioned on work or anything. Just transfer made. So this is smaller part of the program, but it's a very, very important part of the program. So it recognizes, the program recognizes the need to make distinctions between poverty layers within communities. Coming to the second question, and I'm referring now to the many of the evaluations we have done with other colleagues at IFPRI and elsewhere. The first and the most important indicator of the PSMP, according to the PIM, is food security, measured by food gap. Food gap is the number of months that the household is food insecure within the 12 months. So in this measure, we've been evaluating this for the last 12 years, taking biannual surveys, panel data, asking the same households every year, every other year. And the result is that a food gap has decreased from approximately three months in 2006 to 1.75 months in 2014. In other words, the months of food security have increased from 8.9 months, which is close to 9 months in 2006, to 10.3 months in 2014. This is an increase of 1.34 months in food security. This is an average, but remembering that there are variations within this range. A second important element is asset. So we're doing a recent work on this, looking at the data taken 2006 after 2014, and the PSMP has also contributed to actually asset accumulation, although the impact varies by initial conditions, the poorest being the most advantaged in this instance. I can explain this later with some details. It has also reduced vulnerability and increased resilience. A recent study by John Hodgson and others shows that. It has also important local economy implications. My colleagues at IFPRI in Washington and Addis have done this village-level impacts of the injection of cash. What would be the effect of injecting $1 into this village economy? Going down the line, after a year, what happens to that bear? Does it stay one bear or change the system a little bit, and there are some gains as a result? So the simulations showed that there's actually a gain as a result of the PSMP ranging from 1 to 2.4 bear per each bear injected. This is 2.4 bear per each bear invested. This is again as a result of increase in productivity because of the investments made, including the public works. This is again as a result of spillovers, that I gain one bear, I go to the market, I buy something, the person selling that product is getting something out of that, the person that supplied that person is getting something. So in the value chain, there are spillover gains achieved. So this is what is basically implied in this. But in general terms, the total economic benefits of the PSMP exceeds the total cost according to this calculation. This is really, really good news, and one of the grandest results that we have found. So donors, the PSMP costs 1.37% of GDP, Ethiopia's GDP. Out of this, 0.14% is Ethiopia's contribution, national resource contribution. The remaining 1.23% is contributed by the donors. Out of this, there is close to 1% of GDP gain as a result of this investment. These are
criticize the approach of public works programs, arguing, well, it's understandable that the injection of cash into poor communities raises the purchasing power and thereby increases the affordability of food, and of course thereby it reduces malnutrition. But how much more expensive is a program that, I mean, conditions the injection of cash to work? Can you say something on Ethiopia? Does it really pay off? I mean, public works programs are much more expensive than just simple cash transfer programs. Is it worthwhile the effort of really conditioning these transfers? Is the investment component so important that this makes the program, this additional conditioning, the additional costs that are involved useful?
Yeah, thanks again. There are two elements into answering this question. The first is that based on this simulations, that the PSMP public work is actually importantly, bringing gains as a result of the public work investments and the spillover effects afterwards. So you build road, a market is being created, rural road, connecting two rural villages, and then food stuff is coming to the market or going to the village. So all these are in that calculation. So the gains are large in that sense. But the second and most important element of this is that if you continue providing cash transfers to people that can work, then there is always discussion going on about the dependency syndrome that in a way might or might not arise as a result. So the public work component is actually trying to address that, making sure that people are contributing something and getting something as a result. But that contribution, in a sense, although expensive as you mentioned, has not been useless. There are things that you can visibly see if you visit this village. That environment has been rehabilitated. Gully that could have been actually expanded. Soil erosion has been reduced. Soil has been contained. Productivity has increased as a result. Water has started to reflow actually as a result of this activity. Mm-hmm. So it is actually a long, long, long-term perspective of resilience that is coming as a result of this.
Thank you very much. Ralph, social protection play in Malawi for drought response and resilience building? And could Malawi also, I mean, in a way, learn also from the example of Ethiopia? Or could Ethiopia learn from the example of Malawi?
Sector in Malawi is actually a relatively large sector. If you look at several instruments, which are being a cash transfer program, which is targeting the ultra poor and labor constrained, which are about 10% of the population or 10% of the households throughout the country. You have a public works component, which is targeting 15% of the households, which are ultra poor, but able-bodied. So these two instruments target what in Malawi are defined the ultra poor together, these cash transfer programs. And you just for your own setting, we have about 80% below of households living below the international poverty rate of $2 per day. So this is one of the poorest countries in the world, and therefore even a bit poverty is far more widespread than it is in Ethiopia today. There are more programs belonging to the sector, which also are in the context of resilience building and contribution to shock recovery important. School meals programs. Half the schools in the country do provide school meals, some do provide take-home rations, so essentially can even scale up take-home rations when there is, so basically food given to the child coming from a poor household, which the child would take home, particularly during the lean season, so when there is very limited food supply in the rural areas. But also village saving and loan groups are basically falling into the social protection sector in Malawi, as well as pro-poor focused microfinance. So it is a pretty broad mixed bag, if you so wish. And there are some programs which are even in the same domain, but don't officially fall under the sector. The evidence is so far very strong, and that the programs, the cash transfer programs, particularly social cash transfer, which in implementation terms is far better administered today than the public works program, does contribute to household asset accumulation. It does help providing household consumption smoothening during the lean season so that people can continue buying food inputs and actually feed their family. So which has a health effect, which you can also see in decent evaluations. It prevents households from depleting assets, so it's all positive and all but resilience building. The public works program, which is also large, and at some point of time had about the same transfer level, today it's somewhat lower, is going in the same direction. The administration is not as strong as the social cash transfer program, and maybe also to add and amend on the question which I've asked before on the value of public works, it does add value if the assets are properly created. So a cash transfer program in itself, the public works program in itself is far more complex to administer. And creating assets just doesn't mean you need to create just something, you know, dig a hole for the sake of digging a hole, but actually the hole should be good for something and ideally have economic effects, communal, local economy effects, which requires more supervision and, as you say, more effort going into that. So that needs to be well executed, and only then it would make sense. However, I think there was also an interesting hint to the political economy behind. There is a limitation also in the local partner governments, the Malawian government as well, very strong. There is no willingness to give free cash out to people who can work for cash. There's a very clear desire to say, if you are able-bodied and you can work for cash, you're not going to get onto the social cash program. So it's not about an option, you know, just scale a program up which is already existing and shells out free money unconditionally, but saying, if you can work, contribute something. Yeah. But the challenge indeed is get a decent asset done, because a good asset will contribute to resilience building. And there has been in recent years a shift in Malawi in the assets which a program aims to create. So there has been a strong focus on creating roads, which would basically connect remote villages to markets. That was the idea. And it's important, has been some success, but the recent effort goes towards creating, rehabilitating environment, more and better use of water, recreation of the soils in order to also harvest better, to create more agricultural land, which is very similar to the approach taken in Ethiopia. I think it is the right direction to take, because Malawi is suffering from severe environmental degradation. Afforestation, there's a study which estimated if we continue going the current rate of deforestation by 2040, the last tree is gone. We have a very high population density. So you need to essentially also invest in the natural resources in order to have this resource, it's a natural resource, contribute to resilience building. Yeah, and that's an important factor. And there it is a clear question to all sectors, including social protection, contribute to the same. You know, what's your contribution on making this work? So I do think with the saving groups, which are very widespread, the groups, the households can draw on several instruments. Are they all well functioning already? No, they are not. Yeah? Many are. It's going in the right direction. And I think with more system building, and you mentioned that in your presentation, it's not about, you know, just bringing the right instruments out. You need to essentially make sure that they work with each other and that they are implemented in a manner that they do add value.
Also supporting the Malawi Social Cash Transfer Program, act of the program on resilience. And I mean, it doesn't have this public good investments as the cash transfer programs, but does it still contribute also to the availability of food, meaning to the production side, rather than just the affordability of food?
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, I would like to hint that some of the conclusions drawn by Martina, I think exactly apply also to the Malawian example in terms of long-term engagement and support, which is required in fact to generate some success. We do support the cash transfer program, in fact, and it's addressed, as Ralph said, to the 10% ultra poor, which are labor constrained. And we have had some thorough evaluation. It's a program which is started with very first inception activities by UNICEF in 2006 already, was taken up by the German side in 2009, and in fact after a long time of preparation we started in 2012, 2013, now reaching a very broad coverage, in fact of 15 districts out of 28 by German and EU activities administered by KfW. So that allows already for some kind of evaluation, which has been addressed by your question. We do have very clear impacts in the area of food security in terms of increased affordability, in fact, of food. We do observe positive impacts in the area of health. We do also see very positive impacts on the pressure of adolescents leaving school and going to work or going to look for other activities. And we do as well observe in spite of it being at a very, very low level, increased productivity on the household level, and we also have clearly observed the regional economic influx the program has in terms of we use a figure of like 1.7 increase in value in the local economies by injecting one, in this case, kwacha. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you very much. We have been talking a lot now on food security and resilience. And you have argued and you've given examples that it really shows that social transfer schemes, public work schemes can have a huge impact in that regard. However, we have to keep in mind, of course, that nutrition depends much more than on the food affordability and food availability, but also on behavioral factors, yeah? Such as the choice of food, the preparation of food, childcare habits, and so on. So, Gush, can you tell us something if social protection can also have an effect on these behavioral factors of good nutrition?
Thank you. So let me start from the effect of the PSMP on nutrition, the previous PSMP. Now there is a new phase of PSMP with a nutrition sensitivity in it. One reason that the PSMP did not have a meaningful impact on nutrition outcomes was that nutrition elements like behavioral communication features were not included deliberately into the program, and the implementation on that side was weak. So this experience tells you that but just providing food, making food accessible at the household level, or even diet diversity, which was also the positive outcome of the PSMP at the household level, does not necessarily child health and nutrition, good child health nutrition outcomes. So, but then a careful design of programs like the PSMP, where you use the PSMP as social protection as a way of transmitting relevant information as regards to child feeding practices, care practices, hygiene practices, would be very critical, because that's one way of accessing communities. So it's a platform to channel information that is relevant, that doesn't exist there. And this information, relevant information, can be channeled to households, and that can have effects on nutrition outcomes.
So you would argue that social protection schemes can be used as channels to build awareness on these, well, I mean, behavioral factors, on knowing how to feed children and so on. Bettina, is there anything more that social protection programs can do to raise the behavior of people?
I think it's a good question, and many people are thinking a lot about the issue in Syria. I'd say yes. So it's extremely important to have like accompanying measures in terms of enrichment of transfer activities. So general, I think there's no doubt about that, but then we'd also have to have a look if that's also resettled by a social protection or a cash transfer scheme, or if it did not rather by other programs who address this kind of issue. So what we observe in Malawi is we do have a successful system in place. It took a lot of work. It's very fragile, so it's extremely important not to overburden it, so not to put too many bits and pieces to the overall program, because it's simply putting a too strong burden on the Malawian government or of the Malawian management of the program. Therefore, I think reflections can of course be whether there's a kind of referral system of better advice, of closer attachment to the system, but I doubt whether it's reasonable to attach that program-wise indeed to the transfer activities.
Thank you. Martina, based on your experience, I mean, we know that there is conditional cash transfer programs that condition the transfer of cash on certain behavioral things like sending children to school, like going regularly to some physician, I mean, at least especially for pregnant women and young children. Would you say that such condition could also include these nutritional impacts?
Yeah, I think in theory it definitely could. I think, I mean, when we look at the wide evidence of cash transfers on food security and nutrition, it's not doing particularly good in terms of nutrition, specifically of younger children. So I think, and I think we have to look at the causes of that, right? So, I mean, one of them could be, so the underlying causes of nutrition, in a way, are access to food, which cash can resolve by facilitating financial access, but also behavior change, as well as like hygiene. And I guess having like awareness raising workshops linked to conditional cash transfers, like for example in Mexico's program Oportunidades, could try to lead to that kind of behavioral change. So it could be done. But the other thing is also the very specific nutritional requirements that particularly children need during in different stages of their life. So the first 1,000 days of a child are critical for the rest of their lives, and they need a very specific type of supplement for that. So that, as our colleague was saying, depends then on making those kind of supplements available. So it could be linked, but I think it also requires very specific responses from the health sector, for example, from schools, and providing these kind of goods.
Thank you very much for hinting also to other sectors. I think we should not never forget that these interventions should not be just focused on just one sector. I would like to raise another issue now, Ralf. Social transfer programs have often been criticized for having rather short-term compensatory effects. I mean, providing cash, improving productivity on the short term, but not solving the real problem, the vulnerability of people to the volatility of rainfall, harvests, prices, and so on. And as I have heard and as I've learned from discussions with you and with my colleagues, this very consideration stood also at the beginning of GIZ's current activities in Malawi, which have been designed as a multidimensional approach, combining activities in the field of social protection with other activities. And as I've learned in your current project, you combine cash transfers with microfinance, awareness campaigns, and agricultural services. Can you tell us a little bit on the experience of this mixture of these mixed social and economic interventions in your approach?
In a nutshell, sure. It is true. I mean, a short-term transfer doesn't solve anything. Generally, the transfers in Malawi already are multi-year commitments. The social cash, it's a 3 to 4 year, even the public works program has a 3 year commitment, so that you can actually really try to unfold a longer lasting impact on households. Linking these households with saving groups, you know, when they have cash actually that they can also save in the lean season, before the lean season, ideally a bit of money for when prices in the lean season rise, they can actually buy some food. But we thought also, ideally, there are households which need the protective function of social protection, so which can't really get on their own feet, and which, you know, because they are labor constrained, disabled in a very severe sense. But there are also a number of households which, you know, if you give them a helping hand, they can get back on their own feet. And that's actually where we are trying to see how the combination of getting these households into a saving group, giving them a consumption support for a period of time, and then some training on financial literacy, on business skills, and at some point of time, the money for a small productive asset, so they can generate an own income stream independent of the cash transfer. And with that income stream, essentially build up a small business and then get off the consumption support at some point of time, but stand on their own feet. I think this has been an interesting experience for us, which we piloted in one district and had to ask the DIE to do some research and evaluation on it, because I was impressed that it's not only the, I thought, you know, look, if you inject an extra amount of cash with which people can buy an asset, I mean, at the end you see that cash making the difference, yeah, the training, I've who needs a bit of training. But it was very impressive to see that actually people who got nudged to do, you know, do something business, they wanted to all do something business. They were very interested in, you know, let me start something. Whether they got a cash transfer on top or not, we had different groups, so there were some groups which only got the training. But even those without the transfer, they're very keen on actually getting some business started. And that was very encouraging.
So they used the cash for risk diversification in the end?
Many use the cash to actually buy a goat, which is a productive asset.
Right.
Some also used it to buy some food, some more maize, because the program just started, particularly before the main lean season, which was El Nino induced, you know, where we had the most severe food insecurity situation coming up, which we had for quite a long time, where in the last season 40% of the Malawian households have been on food and emergency help and humanitarian assistance, which was really massive because of rain failures. Yeah.
So social protection is a starting point for economic activities in the end, as a for the kind of investments that we need, the investment among the poor, as a prerequisite for proper growth. Bettina, a recent post that I've read by Debbie Hillier on Oxfam blog argues that international action response to drought comes often very late, even though the droughts have been forecasted for months earlier. And even though it would have been much cheaper for international donors if they had provided help much earlier, before the drought actually culminated. And as I understand it, right, this very notion stood at the beginning of what is being called the African Union's African Risk Capacity that KfW is supporting. It's as I understand it it's a kind of an insurance facility that means to help African governments to react much faster to drought and thereby build resilience. Can you tell us a little bit on that facility? And would you say that this facility, this insurance, is also a form of social protection on the macro level?
Okay, thank you. Just to give a short introduction for those who might not be familiar with the African Risk Capacity, we have the African Risk Capacity Agency, which has been politically set up by the AU together with the World Food Programme in 2012, and it's joined by the ARC Insurance Company Limited, which is somehow the management branch of the ARC. The ARC intends to provide indirect insurance in terms of, it's not the people benefiting who are directly insured, but it's an insurance by the government. And it's, as you mentioned, it's index-based. It's observing weather conditions by some satellite activities. And the intention is to reach what we call the benefits of early action, in fact, to detect an approaching disaster and to provide very very quickly help in order not to run into the regular humanitarian crisis mode. By that means the countries participating in the ARC need to fulfill special conditions in order to be eligible for participation. They need to provide some kind of memorandum of understanding where duties and obligations, etc. They need to provide something which is called contingency plan, which is to describe what's going to happen with funding in case of disaster, and when a disaster in fact comes, that's still to be operationalized in an operation plan. And of course, the countries need to pay the insurance fee, which is submitted like on an annual basis. So the insurance has been set up in 2012. There have been cases in 2014-15 where payments have been taken place, and it's also only since 2014 like really operational. There have been some countries in Western Africa benefiting from payments. Action Aid refers to the case of Malawi, where some complications came into the field, which have a lot to do with the wrong customization of the model of the ARCs using the African risk view. It's called, in terms of providing wrong input relating to mice seeds, in fact, which were used in Malawi. So as this is a parameter which strongly influences the insurance model, it didn't trigger a disaster event by wrong like modulation of the insurance. That in fact led to a very, very late disbursement long after the disaster took place, and caused a lot of uproar in the community. And I think ActionAid very much responds to the perspective they have, in fact, from their activities on the ground and their activities in rural areas, saying it's much better to go via, I would rather call it very classical, very strongly NGO-based approach in advising people, in providing for better productive means, etc. I think what they mistook on one hand is that the ARC is addressed, that's a government insurance, so it's the government of Malawi being in charge not only of paying the premium, but also for proposing how to distribute the covered insurance funding. So if it's by food or by social protection scheme or by whatsoever, that's a decision of the government of Malawi. And that said, I think the ARC is not a solution for everything. So it's certainly not to replace other mechanisms already in place. It can be, I think, a very important cornerstone in terms also of the Egyptian example you brought at the very beginning, which should encourage states, in fact, also to have a longer term and also insurance related view. And from that point of view, I think it's a means of social protection if it's carefully handled by the governments participating, and if it's also carefully managed, of course, by the ARC, which requires, I'd say, some maybe kind of really long-term, also long-term commitment by, of course, in terms of risk pooling as many countries as possible.
Thank you. Very interesting. So it's much more a reinsurance if you consider the state as the insurer of households. It's a reinsurance on the macro level.
Exactly.
Martina, might that be the way forward for donors? I mean, including international organizations or groups of donors to go to say, well, once we have supported national governments or given policy advice how to design social protection systems on the national level, go a step further and say, well, we could simply support such reinsurance arrangements like the African risk capacity as a means where we can bring in our funds reinsuring, and thereby also encouraging national governments to build up national insurance, national social protection schemes, be it social insurance, be it social transfer, be it public works programs, and thereby insuring them against, I mean, macro shocks like economic crisis, like weather shocks or so on.
Yeah, I think it's definitely like the pooling of funds, and to have, especially having funds available that are earmarked for a particular purpose is critical to respond in time. And if you manage to do that at a regional level, I think that could contribute, if done well, considerably to just coordination of efforts as well as coordination of like funds from international donors. But I think there is one important distinction. So as far as I understand the African risk capacity, and I'm not too familiar with it, but it would be for the case of an emergency, right? So you would have, in case of food emergencies, you would kind of have those funds to disburse them. It wouldn't be, I don't know if it would be the funding for social protection, core social protection programs like social assistance programs, pensions, and so on, right? So I think that's an important distinction to make. So the funding for social protection is different. and would have to come from more, in order to ensure sustainability, would have to eventually come from national sources. And I think a lot of countries are moving towards funding eventually their social protection programs nationally through taxes. But obviously for the kind of short term and to respond to bigger emergencies, I think pooling funds at the regional level, it would be a really, really good way of going ahead if we managed to do it.
I would have a number of additional questions concerning this very issue and the others as well, but I think it's time now to open the panel for questions from you, from the audience. Thank you very much.
Talking about social protection perspective and interventions at a meso and micro level, what do you think are key elements that these interventions should have to make communities actually drought resilient? I would like to share with you the example in the Cash for Asset program in Kenya. It's a joint program with WFP, the NDMA agency from the government. This program has been implemented for the last 5 years, more or less, and they are doing harvesting, rainwater harvesting technologies while doing cash transfers, right? But with this recent drought, they found that the communities that were got hit stronger by the drought were actually not resilient enough, even though the communities have been in the program for the last 5 years. So what do you think is missing from these programs that can actually make communities resilient in the long term? Thank you.
Does social protection come into effect? At what kind of severity and frequency of droughts, especially as you were also saying, Markus, that drought is nothing what happens very sudden, like an earthquake, but usually it can be foreseen. If you have an early warning system in place, you also have the chance of early action, and then you can place forecast-based financing, social protection, into the broader framework of disaster risk management, and you have a layered approach.
Thank you.
Protection come into effect. It should be there with drought and without drought. So the social protection is something which is all year round. Yeah. The question is, you know, what can we do with social protection systems to help build the resilience to drought, and how can we use then also ideally the system to potentially make a drought response more efficient, to channel it quicker to people to be early on. I mean, you mentioned forecast financing and all these things, early warning systems, I think you also mentioned it. I mean, ideally you don't start only acting, you know, when the drought is there. Ideally we have created, and that's also already linking to you, to your question, Victoria, you have created a little bit more resilience in the community by, I think, water harvesting is a good approach. It's not a social protection approach alone. You know, social protection can contribute building these things by having public works oriented in that direction. You could have a geo-biased targeting to hazard-prone areas where you have more public works building more disaster risk management-related assets, you know, from dams to more water harvesting to diversification, fish ponds, you know, other things which might essentially, very classical rural development, which might essentially link to more income sources, diversify income away from drought infected, you know, livelihoods where people would potentially earn their money somewhere differently as well. So it's all a question of how you use the instruments to enhance it. And whether a 5 year is enough or not, it depends on the severity of the drought. You will always have droughts which essentially break any system, and where you will need to go back to humanitarian response to support people, where the community got more resilient, but not resilient enough to stand through any disaster. So there is also a limit of what such a system can do. But I think essentially it is really something, Gabi, which should be running throughout the time and essentially can scale up, scale down, and be very sensitive and focused on drought contribution to drought response.
For the questions, first of all, maybe to the question about resilience and the example of the irrigation program, and generally maybe opening up a bit the whole idea around resilience and drought. I mean, drought is the kind of the problem. It's a shock or stress that people experience. They're not vulnerable just because of drought. So we have to kind of like start to understand vulnerability also when we talk about resilience and climate change, or not start, we're doing it already, but actually talk about it in a wider sense. So what are the different causes of vulnerability? Is it just because there was a drought? Or is it actually because the livelihoods are unsustainable, because there's no access to markets, because productivity has gone down, because there's inequality, lack of economic growth? These are huge issues that if we've managed to get a good irrigation system in place, that's not gonna then help people if they manage to get a good yield to maybe get the yield to the market, to get a good price for it, because they might not know when there is a good price at the market for that crop. They might not be able to send the kids to school, so they might not be able to find a job. There are lots of other issues that we have to think about when we think about resilience and capacity to deal with shocks and stresses. And the reason why I was so interested in this piece of research that we did was that we really want to open up the discussion also around social protection and building resilience. It's not just about resilience to climate risk, it's generally improving livelihoods that, so that people are less vulnerable to shocks. And a way of doing that, and I think countries are starting to put that in place, is looking at bigger frameworks. So, for example, in Kenya, the Hunger Safety Net program is meant to address chronic food insecurity. It is actually not even aiming to lift people out of poverty. It has very kind of moderate ambitions of what it can do. But it is part of a bigger framework, which is the regional, which is the ending drought emergency framework, which is Kenya's national response to regional effort to deal with drought. And within that framework, there are other pillars. So there is one around livelihood promotion, and access to markets, building value chains. And these are the kind of things we then need at a larger scale to really link social protection programs that are there to stay and that should stay, as Ralph was saying, to link recipients of those safety net programs with other kind of programs that then can help them eventually get out of poverty. And that's not just responding better to drought, that's generally improving livelihoods.
What about possible or beneficial linkages between social protection and other approaches? Can you tell us a little bit about coordination? Who is pushing for this kind of linkages? Who is coordinating? Who is also sometimes enforcing a certain sector to do more? Do we have instruments from the government, from the donor side, who are behind this kind of coordination? And the other question is more our motto of this the similar events is about bringing together development cooperation and research. Maybe we can hear from both sides, from the researchers and from the development practitioners, where they have seen interesting, but maybe also hindering experiences for this linkage research development. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Before the cash transfer program in Mexico, Oportunidades, then I would like to just mention some facts about the behavioral change this brought, because it's a victim of its own success in this, in a sense. First of all, it's given, it's allocated according to how many children a family has. So there's more money involved if a family is bigger. And two, only the women get primarily the funds. That's why it works. Because other
can you tell us anything on bad unintended effects of the existence of social protection because of the way it is designed?
Thank you. We haven't looked at this specifically, but there are recent efforts to understand what's going on with family size, migration, and also dependency. But I think the evidence seems to be that that there is no consistent evidence showing that participation in social protection programs necessarily leads to dependence syndrome or increase in family size. So there is a recent paper that that is on the PSMP showing that there is some differential effect on migration, families going out of the village, and it works more on male than female. Females stay are more likely to stay in the house, and male more likely to go out of the house. Otherwise, we don't see specific results coming from this. But I wanted to chip into the, if you give me the chance, on the conditionalities aspect of social protection. I think conditionalities are important, but conditionalities work only if, for example, the infrastructure to do the conditionalities is in place. For example, if schools are available or health posts are available. If health posts are not in place or schools are not in place, conditioning social protection on this on these conditions would not work or even constrain it. So that's why the PSMP relies on, actually on the flip side of this, incentivizing pregnant women and lactating women to visit, to make health visits, visits to health posts. And participation in BCC is considered as participation in public works, so that they go more often to BCC. So that's what I want to add. Thanks.
Not make the observation that we have like perverse incentives in terms of behavior change at the end of the target group. So I assume that the issue raised with whether you have women-headed households or male-headed households makes a difference. In Malawi, we also do have more than 3/4 of the households headed by women, which might contribute to the positive results. But that's from my side also to a certain extent speculation. On the issue of, if I may, on the issue of development cooperation and research, I think we make the observation that whenever we have a program which has some which has achieved a certain scale, and if we have a country as Malawi with a relatively weak government, we tend to have a lot of actors, a lot of research, and to be honest, for me it's sometimes like it was a playground for trying this or that. So I think that whenever we have some operational perspective, it makes a lot of sense, in fact, of course, to evaluate and to to research aspects, and of course also as an implementer, we very much depend on evaluation results. We depend on lessons learned, because otherwise it would not make sense if we were not in a position to prove that we make something useful and reasonable. There might, however, still be a level of involvement which is a strong burden on the partner side, because very often we have weak ministries. We have in many ministries just one or two or three really able or strong personalities able to answer questions raised, and it's always the same. So if you look at the Malawian government Ministry of Gender and Social Welfare, there are like two persons constantly addressed by different donors, different actors, different researchers. So their capacity is very much absorbed by that kind of activities. So I think there needs to be a good balance in order to make use of it, because I think it would be absolutely stupid for everybody to renounce research activities. They're very vital for the program, but I think it needs to be balanced. And in some cases, my perception is that it might be a little too much and too strong. I think on donor coordination in Malawi, Ralf is much better.
It's coordination. You need it on the donor side, you need it on the government side, because take the Malawian example. Cash transfer belongs to the Ministry of Gender as a responsible. Public Works is Ministry of Local Government. School meals is Ministry of Education. VSL falls into the Ministry of Industry and Trade, and microfinance has recently been shifted back to Treasury. 5 programs, 5 different responsibilities. Ministry of Agriculture comes in with a large farm input subsidy program, and the humanitarian response is being coordinated by the Prime Minister's office, the President's office. So basically, every program, somebody different responsible. Within VSL, you have 67 different implementers. So there is indeed a need for coordination, and it's not simple. Particularly not if you want to set up a harmonized sector with, you know, streamlined payment mechanisms which can be used by different programs, resilience building where different activities indeed come together to lift households. It's not easy. But it's, on the one hand, it's the development partner and donor community which needs to coordinate, but also within the government. In Malawi, we have the somewhat fortunate situation that at least, you know, there is a ministry named to be responsible for coordination, and they do coordinate. Yeah, it's not entirely simple to do so, but it's better than having a vacuum and essentially a fight on, no, it's me responsible, I don't need to coordinate, and so on. So this is the first step, which I think is an important step, and Ethiopia has taken it many years before and very clearly enforcing, you know, where the coordination is lying, and there the donors came much closer together. We have a very good coordination in Malawi as well, but the donors are also pooling their funding, which is the next step in coordination, harmonized funding, so that also a counterpart ministry or a counterpart government doesn't need to report to 15 different funding formats. Yeah, in a district, when you get money from three different sources, you know, different audit requirements, different reporting requirements, which doesn't make life easier to then focus on, you know, a very good implementation. So I think it is requiring, so to sum up, it requires a coordination on the government side, define who is in charge of making sure there is coherence, and it requires coordination on the donor side, which will need to include at some point of time a harmonized financing stream to make it handleable, so that basically can be handled from the government side.
Just one more quick thing about the question around hindering experience between putting research between research and practitioners in a way. I'm not entirely sure where that question was going, but what I was thinking about was that one thing that is challenging is just to have honest evidence on what works and what doesn't work. So when you're conducting research, obviously, I mean, it is commissioned very often by certain development partners, very often with a very strong incentive to show that things are working. And rarely we see reports, but when you try to do like desk-based reviews of existing programs, rarely you see what is not working and why it's not working. And then you go into the field and things are not working. We have to have somehow a more honest reporting on what works and why it doesn't work, even though there has been a lot of money invested in it to really improve things. So this whole rhetoric about around public works programs and assets is really big, and Gush was mentioning there is a very strong political economy factor to that, because people don't want to give money to poor people without doing anything if they can work. So those programs are huge, they're politically very popular. But the effectiveness of the assets is in many cases very questionable. And there is hardly any evidence on whether these assets work or not, and whether they're actually leading to the impact that people are expecting them to have. Yet it is continuously and kind of reproduced. So I think that is something that just generally, I mean, it goes beyond this topic, but it is something that would be really important to be able to really make more meaningful recommendations of what can change.
I really appreciate this last thought about being a bit more critical about the real impact of our efforts, and rather saying that things are not working and trying to identify the weaknesses rather than to just go on. I think I would say we have a time for one last round of questions. So please, hands up now.
Experience. I think they also have about four government-owned programs and one by the World Food Program. But they have the concept of the single registry, which actually gives a general overview of all the programs in the country and helps in the operational management, and also helps to reduce the possibility of a household actually belonging to more than one program. So I want to ask if this has been a consideration for Malawi, for example. Thank you.
For your attention on the possibilities for persons with disabilities to get access to social protection, the background is that we are conducting an evaluation on the German Ministries for Economic Cooperation and Development Action Plan on Inclusion of Persons with Disabilities. We've conducted a case study in Malawi. This is why I would not address this question to Ralf Rademacher or to Bettina Tewinkel. I would rather be interested to get an idea of what are the experiences Gush Behane in with the PSMP program in Ethiopia on providing or giving persons with disabilities access to social security. And Martina, if you could share your experiences on this very important question. Thank you.
Thank you.
And to narrow down on what social protection is, and maybe we are trying to stretch it too much to every sector,
But I don't know the practitioners, what you are doing in the field, whether we need to actually have more horizontal reach rather than deepening it to cover everything that pertains human development. Because I think the examples you've given, Martina, in your presentation, most of them are covering maybe 5-10% of the poor population. The examples in Uganda, I'm from Uganda, and the program only provides cash transfer to 140,000 elderly people, and there's over a million. I think the same thing with the Malawi, you said about 10% of the chronically poor people, only 10%. Ethiopia, 8 million out of, I don't know. So shouldn't we actually focus, help governments focus more on stretching its reach rather than just deepening on everything? Thank you.
I'd like to know how we can link the African risk capacity, or in general the climate risk insurance, to social protection systems, because we think to distribute the payouts to the poor and vulnerable people on the countryside, we need to have secure and no corruptive distribution channels. And
hear any one of you talking about drought policy, national drought policy. I have been working on these issues for many years now, and not many countries have a national drought policy based on the principles of risk reduction. So what is the experience of Malawi? The other thing is, can you just define resilience for me? Are you talking about country level or community level or household level or individual level? I think we need to follow a subsidiary approach. So
thank you very much.
Essentially collect information of potential beneficiary households so that you can, when there is, that you can target those, you know, and if there is essentially another risk coming, you can say who would be affected. Kenya has it, and it's true, and Malawi has one as well. So it's we have helped developing a central database where the social cash transfer will target beneficiaries from, the public works will target beneficiaries from, and if there are supplementary interventions coming, it should also target from there. Apart from the targeting, programs are reporting back to that database on who actually was treated, who actually got a certain benefit, so that we can learn whether certain combinations of programs lead households quicker out of poverty. That's currently in the database is being populated. So basically there's data collection going on right now. And within this year, the first 10 districts should be covered up to 50% of the population in that database. And we hope that we can actually go up to 100% in several districts which are disaster prone.
Maybe just a question around whether you can deliver climate risk insurance through existing social protection systems. I think what is critical there is to have that system in place. And maybe it just makes sense to quickly summarize how the one in Kenya works, for example. So the Hunger Safety Net program started building up this shock responsive system through the targeting exercise. So they went into drought-prone communities, identified vulnerability of households, and categorized people in extremely chronically food insecure households and those that are vulnerable to food insecurity. And then they're given cards, right? And the ones that are extremely vulnerable, they get permanent support, and the other ones also get a card, and then they kind of like, in the case of an emergency, they are able to just get the money on that card. Then you have a vegetation index in place. You have defined at what stage that you kind of have that trigger. You have memorandum of understanding with the different disaster management authorities, with the different funds, with the Ministry of Finance. And that whole system is running, right? So that's when you can do that kind of thing. You can have an index-based insurance, for example, triggered out through that system. But in many places, that doesn't necessarily is not necessarily the case. Or social protection itself is quite fragmented between different ministries. You have different targeting systems. You have different delivery systems. So then it doesn't necessarily make sense to tag that on. So it really depends on a case-to-case basis. And what kind of elements of a social protection systems do you need to have for this to work? So we can't just say across the board it is a good idea. It really depends on what is there and how well it works.
We take that on the horizontal reach on the horizontal reach versus the deepening you mentioned. I think a tremendous important issue is the responsibility taken on by funding social protection schemes. So from the German government side, for example, in the case of Malawi, we have a very substantial long-term commitment of many millions funding into the social protection scheme of Malawi, and there are other donors doing the same. The Malawian government struggles very much in contributing a very small share of, let's say in the German context, it's around 10% of the overall program cost. Out of 28 districts, Malawi itself doesn't even manage to fund one single district completely and in a satisfactory manner. So I think the issue of just horizontally expanding programs in view of sustainability requirements should be very critically assessed. So even because now we have a running program, there's a lot of donor interest, but I think that it's a critical sign to say we go into some kind of horizontal expansion just because we have some more funding available. I think we should rather focus very much on the ability of the Malawian government to better contribute themselves to the program in terms of capacity and also in terms of limited funding. I mean, it is at the end of the day, it's very strong humanitarian intervention addressing at the 10% ultra poorest. So I think very well justified to go for that approach. But still, I think horizontal expansion should be very carefully addressed. The deepening, which also is discussed in the Malawian context, and I think, in fact, a potential link between ARC and the protection system under the exact conditions you mentioned, looking at very country-specific context, could be some kind of deepening of activities as well as dispersing or attaching further activities. I think in the long run that can be extremely useful, and also has a much better base by the UBR, as Ralph has mentioned, the Unified Beneficiary Registry, which provides also an instrumental basis in order to go for that direction. But I think it's still a long way to go, at least in the Malawian context.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Just to add on the stretching of resources to more people horizontally you mentioned. I think this is, so what do we want to do with social protection is the question, the first question. And that takes me to the fact that what is the problem? The problem is that we have several layers of poverty in these communities where you see some of them cannot do anything if you invest in promotional aspects that trickle down component to these households or groups would be like minimal or zero. So these are households with disabilities, health issues, and people that do not have able body to work anywhere in any sense. So these are people who should be on protection forever. These are people for whom the rest of the society should carry for the rest of their life. So the way I see social protection is just as a way forward, that it probably will grow to schemes, national schemes, whereby there is a national social security system in place supporting this part of communities. If you go a little bit higher above this level, there is a good group of members of community that can be supported a little bit and graduate, go up a little bit further and go forever out of social security targeting. So what are we trying to address now is the question. So if you go a little bit higher in the third level, maybe social protection is not the answer. Maybe we need some other promotional investments, such as that can increase productivity, that can increase productive capacity of the household itself, and promote them further. So maybe opportunities are missing, and creating opportunities would be the answer. So that's why community level targeting, going deeper into the community and trying to identify the really, really poorest of the poor who should be in this is the best way to do targeting in these areas. On the disabilities, as far as the PSMP in Ethiopia is concerned, there are two components, as I mentioned in the beginning. There's the public work component, where people work and are paid for the work they contribute. There's a direct support component, which specifically addresses people with health problems, disabilities, HIV/AIDS, families in disarray because of HIV/AIDS, and old age, and all of that. And targeting this group, as far as the PSMP is concerned, has not been difficult, given communities are involved in the targeting process.
Thank you very much, Bettina. Thank you very much, Martina. Thank you very much, Ralph. Thank you very much, Gush. We are almost at the end of this event, but we have the great honor today, and I really appreciate that, to have with us two representatives of the German Federal Ministry of Economic Cooperation and Development. I mean, in the end, the organization that is not only financing this event here, but which is also taking the decisions on where development cooperation, German development cooperation, is going to go in the future now. And I'm happy that both are going to say some concluding words on this event. We have with us Ms. Heike Hen, who is head of the division that is responsible for food security and global nutrition, and Mr. Hurlen, who is desk officer in the division that is responsible for health, population policies, and social protection. So please, if you would like to come one after the other, perhaps, to say some conclusions that you draw from the discussion. Thank you.
Thanks also to the panelists and to all the participants for the really very rich and lively discussion. It gave a lot of insights to me, and I hope to everybody else. And I'm also very thankful that I'm not asked to summarize the discussion. At least this is how I understood my task, so I guess. But it was really a very rich discussion, I mean, that highlighted the complexity, and that maybe people in BMZ don't like too much. I mean, the complexity around drought, resilience, food security, food and nutrition security, the differentiation between social protection programs, as well as also the concept of vulnerability. So these are really complex issues that we try to bring together, or you try to bring together in this event. And so the discussion was very rich, but also not like provided ready-made easy answers. So the examples from Kenya, Malawi, and Ethiopia were very helpful from my perspective to highlight what can work, maybe not so much what didn't work. I mean, this was, I think, something that was not so prominent in this discussion, but the examples really put flesh to the more complex concepts that we have been heard about today. I think everybody mentioned the relevance of the topic, and we in the ministry and the division that I'm heading very much believe in the relevance not only of food and nutrition security, but especially on the linkages with social protection. Mm. We heard about, or the SDGs were mentioned. I mean, we still have very high numbers of hungry and malnourished people. We have all the knowledge about climate change. And so the relevance is there. Many of you mentioned the current food insecurity crisis at the Horn of Africa, in Yemen, and other places, and with high human costs and financial costs. And so we have the need for quick and effective reaction, but even more so of long-term preventive measures. And so my starting point, the starting point of my colleague is something else, but my starting point as head of the Food and Nutrition Security Division, and I come to that why, from my perspective, this is important. My starting point is the right to nutritious food for everybody at all times. even in times of drought or other events. So the question for me and for this event then was, okay, what is the role of social protection in this context? Has it the potential to deliver for this objective? And I was happy to be invited because I strongly believe that the linkage is there, that the potential is there, and I think the discussion has shown where the potential lies. And if we then combine it with where the problems are and how we can do better on what is not working, I think that then we can really use, or we should use, the potential that is there in social protection for food and nutrition security. But what is necessary to realize this potential? We heard a lot, and rightly so from my perspective, about the need to differentiate between the different programs and our approaches, to think about targeting of really careful analysis, and also of coordination. I think we discussed also nutrition, but from my perspective, in the overall discussion, maybe even today, it's still too much focus on food security. But the understanding of nutrition as being really a cornerstone for resilience, and that we cannot forget about possibilities to incorporate in short-term, medium-term, and long-term reaction, also in social protection, not to make it over complex. Oh, she's talking about complexity, but then adds another layer. You may be right in this, but still, I think nutrition is really, we cannot think about food security without thinking about nutrition at the same point. So this is at the same moment. So this is really important. Also, monitoring and evaluation in really developing this type of programs, especially the long-term programs, I'm very clumsy, I know, is really important. So these were, from my perspective, some of the outcomes also today on how really to realize the potential that we believe is strongly there in linking social protection with food and nutrition security and drought resilience. But is social protection the silver bullet for drought resilience and food and nutrition security? From my perspective, I don't know what your perspective is, unfortunately not.
I don't believe in silver bullets anyway.
Okay. I believe in gun control, so. I mean, why do I say that? And maybe we all agree. From my perspective, the long-term dynamics created by social protection are limited. And the root causes for droughts, for food insecurity, the effect social protection can really have on tackling the root causes also for vulnerability are really limited. So it's a key program or approach from my perspective, but it has to be really, it can be better when we have clear objectives in mind and know what it can do, linking social protection with food security and nutrition, and what it can't do, cannot do. And also in the times, I mean, of the current food insecurity crisis, when we talk about the Horn of Africa, South Sudan, Somalia, Yemen, north of Nigeria, in times, I mean, when conflict, crisis, fragility are really at the root of the food insecurity crisis, long-term state-owned social programs are obviously not the answer to this type of crisis. So for really also the complexity of food insecurity and drought situations, we need also different instruments and answers. So it's important from my perspective to know what social protection can do but cannot, and what it cannot do. But what is the way forward? Continue to address root causes and strengthening drought resilience. You may know about the special initiative One World No Hunger. You may know of the strong engagement of the German government for climate adaptation and mitigation. So just to mention some on root causes, but also acting on the knowledge of the importance of nutrition for resilience and really addressing it in social protection as well. and act on the evidence that all these key people on the panel share with us, that social protection can play an important role. And I was wondering, while listening to you, because I come also from the discussion on linking relief, rehabilitation, and development, and I was thinking state-owned national social protection programs can be maybe an answer, maybe not the answer, to what we all have been discussing with LRRD concepts for the last 20 years. Yes, it's important, but how do we do it again? So this is something having nationally, nationwide with ownership programs can be maybe something that we can really work on in the future and provide some solutions. I know I'm too long, I will be at the end shortly. But what are the factors to make it happen? We heard a lot about the careful planning coordination. I think we heard a bit less about the necessity to have national ownership on leadership. It came out strongly also in our talk over lunch with you, Mr. Behane. The need of national ownership and leadership, but also the buy-in and the financial support by development partners. And this needs political will on both sides to prioritize social protection, especially given the political economy that was mentioned also briefly, because this is a really, from a political perspective, this is one of the key obstacles when we talk about upscaling social protection programs. The political economy in partner countries, but also in development partner countries. So these are some of the key factors I think we need to address. And I'm very happy that I'm now able to hand over to my colleague, Florian Perlin, from the Social Protection Division, or whatever it's called in detail. We have been working closely, the two divisions, for the last couple of years, also with colleagues from GIZ. And I think this was mainly driven by the fact that both of us personally, but also the colleagues behind it, strongly believe in the added value, in the win-win situation of linking both sectors. And we overcame the obstacles for multisectoral collaboration, because we really, and the colleagues in your division, believed in this approach. So to reach the end of hunger and malnutrition and to leave no one behind, we really have to work jointly on this. Thank you very much for your patience.
I would like to continue with the content part and then come to the thanks part at the end. For a long time, governments of low-income countries were hesitant. Is social protection affordable for us? This is something we did not question this time, but which is actually a relevant point. And given the remarks like how many people are we covering, actually, it comes up again. And during the last decade, this has changed enormously. So we observe a strong trend towards social protection. We have today 40 countries in Africa with unconditional cash transfer programs, which is a doubling since 2010. And tonight we were introduced to the impressive examples of Ethiopia and Malawi. These trends at country level are mirrored at global level. SDG 1.3 calls upon all countries to implement nationally appropriate social protection systems and measures for all. The essential promise of the Agenda 2030, leave no one behind, explicitly sets sight on long and short-term goals. It reminds us to focus on the fight of root causes of poverty and climate change in the long term, and to support those who need help immediately, who cannot wait until the results of long-term strategies will kick in. BMZ therefore strongly supports efforts to enhance basic social protection in developing countries, and the Marshall Plan with Africa of the Ministry envisages support in developing, financing, and insuring, also reinsuring, social protection systems. So what are the messages I would like to take with me, or partly also give to you additionally. One, of course, is we need basic social protection to fight hunger and poverty. We need basic social protection to grapple with the consequences of climate change in Africa and to make people and their livelihoods and the economy in general more resilient. And through basic social protection, poor people are given a chance to take part and benefit from all the good initiatives being developed to improve agricultural production, the economy in general, and livelihood systems, which is also supported by the German Development Cooperation in other fields. I'm thinking also, for example, on professional training, but you need the basis for professional training, so you need to have the possibility to attend it and not to work. So I also would like to say many thanks for also addressing some of the challenges involved, because we need to overcome them, because social protection is a condition, a basic condition for rural development, for strengthening resilience, and for poverty reduction. And however, as Mr. Rademacher said, we need social protection if there is a drought, and we need it if there is no drought. So social protection is a right, and but in particular cases, the social protection systems could be scaled up to address the consequences of a drought. Of course, it cannot prevent, but it can maybe prevent that a drought becomes a serious famine. And this is what we can see. And with public works programs, maybe it's also possible to address, to contribute to addressing, say, at least some of the root causes also of climate change and droughts. And with regards to the right to food, I think again the right to social protection could be a sub basis for the right to food, to make it fulfilled, to make it a reality. And there, I think we also have this right based approach, which might be helpful to get more momentum for these initiatives. So we are very glad about the intense cooperation with Mrs. Hen and her team from the One World No Hunger initiative of BMZ during the last 2 years. And together with colleagues from GIZ, KfW, and the German Development Institute, KfW, who are hosting us tonight, we could illuminate the role and potential of social protection for food security and resilience. And this panel discussion we did today, but also two publications, I would like to mention the role of social protection for food security and basic social protection as a basis for rural development and nutrition. You can find here. These are German language publications, I have to say, but this is the main audience we as a ministry have to focus on. I would also like to extend my deep appreciation and thanks to all those who have made this event possible and to our honored guests. Thank you for your contributions and the fruitful discussion. I would invite you to continue it with some drinks, I think rather unalcoholic than alcoholic. So at least they will not have any negative effects on the productivity. And afterwards, outside in the entrance hall. Many thanks to all of you.